all my dear student friends, welcome to this session. So we are studying the subject power engineering and refrigeration, and second topic is going on, that is IC engine testing. Now while testing the IC engine, it is very important to understand that how much power of the engine is wasted, is lost in the form of frictional power. So we have the formula, frictional power is equal to indicated power minus brake power. So indicated power is that power which is developed inside the engine cylinder due to the combustion of the fuel. But all this power is not converted into brake power, all the this indicated power is not available at the crankshaft of the engine as useful work, as useful power, which is called as brake power, because some power is lost as frictional power. Therefore frictional power is equal to indicated power minus brake power. It means that the useful power which is available at the crankshaft of the engine is not equal to the indicated power which is developed inside the engine cylinder due to the combustion of the fuel. So why this brake power is less than indicated power, or why indicated power is greater than brake power? The reason is that the power is lost, some power is lost in friction between the various moving parts like the bearings, the piston and cylinder, the valves and the valve seat, the gears, the pulleys and the belts. So there are several moving parts, and these moving parts are in contact with each other. A particular surfaces of these moving parts, they are in contact with each other, and the contact area suffers with friction, wear and tear. So the power is lost, sufficient power is lost in overcoming this friction which is present between the various moving parts of the engine which are in contact. Then there are some pumping losses. So during the suction stroke there is a pumping loss, because some power is required to suck the air from the atmosphere inside the engine cylinder. Some power is required to compress the air inside the engine cylinder, compress the charge, and power is also required, or power is also lost or wasted in driving out the exhaust gases out of the engine cylinder. So these losses are called as the pumping losses. In addition to that, some power is lost in overcoming the resistance of the flywheel. The flywheel will store the excessive energy and it will provide the energy when it is required. So this flywheel is rotating with a high speed, and this flywheel will face the resistance of the air. So in order to overcome the resistance of the air, some power is also lost. Then we have to drive certain accessories. The engine itself will drive certain accessories like the fuel pump, the water pump, that is the cooling water pump. Then when we switch on the AC, the compressor of the AC is also driven by the engine itself, the engine crankshaft itself. Then for the power steering also, the power is lost in driving these accessories. The hydraulic actuators of the power steering are driven, and that also consumes the power. Then for charging the battery, and the battery is charged, the charge in the battery is used to drive the starter motor, then for operating the power windows, and for running the cooling fan, and the operation of the windshield wipers, the music players, the lights, etc. So many things, a lot of load is there on the battery, and the engine is charging the battery. So there also some power is required, or some power is lost. So this is the reason why the indicated power is greater than the brake power, and there is some frictional power inside the engine. So we have to find this frictional power. To find the frictional power, we are using the Mohs test. The experiment which we are using is called as the Mohs test, which can be performed in the laboratory, and we are having the equipment in the laboratory, and that equipment is called as the Mohs test equipment. And the aim of the experiment is to find the frictional power and mechanical efficiency of a 4-cylinder IC engine. The apparatus include the 4-cylinder IC engine whose power is required to be determined, then the cutoff device, the dynamometer and the tachometer. The procedure lies in measuring the brake power by first of all measuring the force by using the dynamometer. So force is multiplied by the radius, that gives the torque, and when torque is multiplied by the angular speed, we get the power. So we find the brake power. We estimate the brake power by practically measuring the force, and we are also measuring the speed, but speed is some given speed that is maintained constant, so the speed is also required to be measured. And first of all, we are keeping all the cylinders working, all the cylinders are producing power, and then we are measuring the force and we are measuring the speed, and thus we are estimating the brake power, the total brake power which is given by the operation of all the 4 cylinders of that particular engine, and that is denoted as B1234. Now after that, we are cutting off the cylinders one by one. We cut off each cylinder one by one and change the load, keeping the speed constant. We change the load and we keep the speed constant, and we again measure the force. So force is nothing but the load multiplied by the gravitational acceleration 9.81, right? So W is nothing but the load or the weight that is multiplied. If that value is in kg, in order to convert it into Newton, we have to multiply by 9.81, then we get the force. So the force is multiplied by the radius of the dynamometer, then the we get torque. This torque is multiplied by the angular speed, and that gives us the brake power. So in this way, we estimate the brake power by cutting off the various cylinders one by one. So for example, if we cut off the cylinder number 1, we get the brake power B234. Then again, next time we cut off the cylinder number 2, then we get B134, and so on. If we cut off the cylinder number 3, we denote the obtained brake power as B124, and finally when we cut off the cylinder number 4, the brake power obtained or estimated is denoted as B123. So the calculations in the experiment in this experiment we have to just find the brake power. We know the formula for brake power is 2 pi nt upon 60. So T is the torque, and 2 pi n upon 60 is the angular speed. So torque T is equal to force into radius, where radius may be given for that particular equipment. So in our laboratory, we are using the hydraulic dynamometer, and the radius at which the force is applied is 0.3 meters. So that is to be multiplied by the force F, which we get on the dial indicator. That is the resisting force which is caused due to the dynamometer. We are using the hydraulic dynamometer, and the force which resists the motion of the crankshaft of the engine is measured by the dynamometer, which is having the dial gauge. Then the force will be equal to the weight, or that particular reading which we get in kg, that reading is in kg, so that is to be multiplied by the gravitational acceleration 9.81. So we get the force in Newton, and that is multiplied by the torque, right? So actually this force is multiplied by the radius. So 9.81 W into R is nothing but the torque which we obtain. The weight W is in kg and N is RPM, revolutions per minute, and that RPM is measured, but it is kept constant for the all the various readings. So ultimately we get the brake power as 2 pi into 9.81 WRN upon 60, because we just put the value of T as 9.81 WR. T is the torque. Now what we do is that we write this brake power in this form, WN upon K. So K is the constant. So once we find the value of K, every time we need not find the complete value, we just put the value of K, because K is a constant. So that we can find the value of K only once and put the value, because what is the variable is W and N. Actually N also we are keeping constant. The RPM is kept constant, and what is variable is just W. So this W is nothing but the force or the weight in kg, that reading which of the dynamometer, right? So that is the only reading which we have to take. Of course speed also we are required to measure, but speed we are maintaining constant by changing the load. We vary the load and then we assure, we ensure that the speed is constant. And ultimately you can find from these two equations, K is equal to 60 upon 2 pi 9.81 into R. We know that R is equal to 0.3 meter, so I have not written the value of R, because if the dynamometer changes then the value of R may change, right? So in this way, first of all find the value of K only once, and then every time very easily you can get the value of brake power, because you have to find the brake power several times. First of all we find B1, 2, 3, 4. So this time all the cylinders are working. At the beginning all the cylinders are working, no cylinder is cut out. So we get the total brake power of the total engine when all the cylinders are contributing their power, and that is denoted as B1, 2, 3, 4. Now when we cut the cylinder number 1, we get B2, 3, 4, and in this way we get B1, 3, 4, B1, 2, 4 and B1, 2, 3, right? So by using this formula we can get all these 5 values. So in order to obtain B1, 3, 4, we cut out the cylinder number 2. When we cut out the cylinder number 3, we obtain B1, 2, 4, and B1, 2, 3 is obtained when the finally last cylinder number 4 is cut out. So the procedure of Mohr's test consists in running the engine against a dynamometer. We are using some dynamometer, either hydraulic dynamometer or even we can use the rope brake dynamometer. So the power of the engine is absorbed by a dynamometer, and the speed is known, because we have to keep the speed constant. Because when the speed is constant, the frictional power is assumed to be constant. That is one of our assumptions. So we are just measuring the speed and we are maintaining a particular speed which we can keep constant for all the readings. So the engine is started and it is run against a dynamometer. That means the dynamometer is absorbing the power of the engine, and that is done at a particular speed. And first of all the cylinders are producing the power, and we estimate the total power. Then we cut out the cylinder one by one. So cutting out the firing of each cylinder. So if we are using the SI engines, then the spark plug is cut out. That means if no electricity is given to the spark plug, then the spark will not be produced by the spark plug, and the power will not be produced by that particular cylinder. So in this way we are cutting out the firing of each cylinder in turn, and we are noting the load and estimating the brake power each time while maintaining the speed constant. So speed is maintained constant by changing the load, and every time we estimate the brake power by noting down the load on the engine. So when one cylinder is cut off, power developed is reduced and speed of the engine falls. So if you cut off one cylinder, automatically the power developed will be reduced. Something like 75% power will be produced or 25% power will be reduced. So the speed of the engine will automatically fall. But we are maintaining the speed by decreasing the load. We have to adjust the load. So in this case, we have to decrease the load. If you decrease the load to a certain value, then we can maintain the speed constant. And we can note down the force. And we can estimate the brake power. We can note down the load or the force. So accordingly, the load on the dynamometer is adjusted so as to restore the engine speed. This is done to maintain frictional power constant. So when the speed is constant, it is assumed that the frictional power is also constant. So we want to measure the frictional power, therefore it is necessary to keep it constant. And for that purpose, we are maintaining the speed constant and we are changing the load on the engine. So this speed is supposed to be independent of the load. Sorry, frictional power is supposed to be independent of the load. So frictional power depends upon the speed. It doesn't depend on the load. That is our assumption, right? And it is true up to a considerable extent. So we have to make certain assumptions. Then only we can go ahead and we can estimate, we can find something, and we can go ahead with our experiment. And this frictional power is considered independent of the load and proportional to the engine speed. So the frictional power is supposed to be proportional to the engine speed and independent of the load. So we are varying the load but keeping the engine speed constant. So that is the important, though neglected, but that is important assumptions of the Morse test. So we should know the assumptions of the Morse test. What are the assumptions made for Morse test? The mechanical or frictional losses at constant speed are independent of the load. So if the speed is constant, the frictional loss or the mechanical loss in the engine is independent of the load. So even if the load varies, the frictional and mechanical losses will not vary if the speed is maintained constant. That is the important assumption number one made for the Morse test. Assumption number two is that the frictional and pumping power of the cutout cylinder remains the same after cutting out as it was when the cylinder is fully operative or developing power, because cutout period is very short. Now, since the cutout period is very short, there is no change in the frictional power developed by the engine. In frictional power present in the engine, the frictional power and the pumping power which is present in the engine will not be changed, because the cutout period is very short. Even if that particular cylinder is not producing power or that particular cylinder is cut out, so the frictional and pumping power of a cutout cylinder remains the same after cutting out as it was when the cylinder is fully operative, because cutout period is very short. So even if the cylinder is developing power, that time the frictional power is same as that when that particular cylinder is cut out or not developing power, because the cutout period is very short. That is the assumption number two. Now there is one small precaution also, so that we are to take for the Morse test. Before cutting out the next cylinder, engine should be run on all cylinders for a short time. So for a small time or for a short time, we run the engine on all the cylinders before we cut out the next cylinder. Suppose we cut out the cylinder number one first of all, then after that we cut out cylinder number two. But In between, for some time, we run the engine with all the four cylinders working. Getting this? So that precaution we have to take so that the temperature of the engine is maintained. The several other parameters are also maintained. It will get some time to settle down, and then we can cut out the next cylinder. Immediately we should not cut out the second cylinder or the third cylinder after we restore the first cylinder, right? Now let us go to the actual Mohs test. We have seen the aim of the experiment is to find the frictional power and mechanical efficiency of a four cylinder IC engine. The apparatus we require is the four cylinder IC engine, cutout, device, dynamometer and tachometer, etc. So this can be the lab equipment, and here we have the cutoff device. So we are having four levers, 1, 2, 3, 4. We can see these four levers shown by red color. So we have to operate these levers to cut out the cylinders one by one. So you operate the lever number 1, then cylinder number 1 will be cut out. That means the battery will not supply electricity to the spark plug of cylinder number 1. If the position of the lever number 1 is changed, if you push this lever number 1 to the other side, right, or say in the upward direction, if you push this, if you move this lever number 1 in the upward direction, then what will happen? Cylinder number 1 will be cut out. And if you push the lever number 2 in the upward direction, then what will happen? Cylinder number 2 will be cut out. Okay, if you want to restore it, then you can pull the lever back at its original position, at this given position, right? So the procedure lies in measuring the force. We have to measure the force, or we have to measure the load W. So that load W is in kg, so multiplied by 9.81, so that you get force in Newton. And that force can be multiplied by radius r, so that you get force into radius is torque. And then you measure the speed, so torque is multiplied by angular speed. Speed is n rpm, but you take angular speed, that is 2 pi n upon 60. So 2 pi n t upon 60 is the brake power. So you measure the force, that is 9.81 into W is the load, and you also measure the speed, right? In fact, you have to maintain the speed at a particular value which is suitable for carrying out the trial, something like 1100 rpm or 1000 rpm. That rpm of the engine is maintained, and we keep all the cylinders working at the beginning first of all, and we find the load W, and the speed is also measured, and we estimate the brake power. How to find the brake power? The formula we have seen previously, right? So this brake power, when all the four cylinders are working, we call it as B1234. Then after that, we cut out cylinder, we cut off each cylinder one by one and measure the load W, and it is multiplied by 9.81 to get the force, and thus we estimate the brake power. But we are keeping the speed constant. Whatever speed we are maintaining when we find B1234, the same speed we are maintaining when the cylinder number 1 is cut out, or when the cylinder number 2 is cut out. So while taking all the readings, we are maintaining the speed constant, right? And we estimate these values, B234, B134, B124 and B123. So I told you what is B234 and 134, right? So when we cut out the cylinder number 1, say suppose this lever we move, once again I will show it, this lever is pushed in the upward direction, right? So the cylinder number 1 is cut out. Now the load on the engine will be increased because the power developed will be reduced, because the number of cylinders which are active, which will be developing power, are only 3. So this will reduce the speed of the engine. The speed of the engine will be reduced. So what we have to do is that using the dynamometer, we have to reduce the load. If it is a hydraulic dynamometer, then we can operate the valve. Suppose this is the valve. We just operate the valve, right? And we reduce the load on the engine. We decrease the pressure or the flow rate of the water. So the load is reduced, right? And the load is reduced till the speed is maintained constant. Till the speed is also restored to the original speed when all the 4 cylinders were working, and that time also we have estimated the power, that is brake power, that is B1, 2, 3, 4, and now we have cut off cylinder number 1 by moving this lever 1 in the upward direction, and we find the power, we estimate the brake power by measuring the load and then using the formula, measuring, restoring the speed, and we find the brake power B2, 3, 4. Now here you can see that when cylinder number 1 is cut off, the brake power estimated will be B2, 3, 4, right? So after taking the readings, we restore this cylinder number 1. We restore the cylinder number 1. That means this lever is brought back to its original position. Now all the 4 cylinders are working. All the 4 cylinders are working. So let the engine run for some time with all the 4 cylinders working, so that the engine will stabilize, the temperatures will be stabilized, right? And then you cut off the second cylinder. Cylinder number 2 is cut off now, right? By moving this lever in the upward direction, cylinder number 2 is cut off, and the same procedure is repeated. We find the power, we estimate the brake power by measuring the force W or the load W. But if there is some variation in the speed, we have to change the load and again keep the speed constant. We have to restore the speed by slightly changing the load, because this time we have to slightly change the load slightly only, because previously the cylinder number 2, 3, 4 were working. Now cylinder number 1, 3, 4 are working, right? So slight change in the load may be required to restore the speed, but we have to restore the speed, we have to maintain the speed constant, and we find the load W. We find the load W, and using the formula for brake power, we estimate B1, 3, 4. We estimate B1, 3, 4, okay, because cylinder number 2 is cut out. Now again we restore the cylinder number 2, this lever is pulled back. Now again we run for some time, we run all the engine on all the 4 cylinders for some time, for a very short time. And now again what we can do is that we can cut off the cylinder number 3. We can cut off the cylinder number 3. So there will be change in the speed. So we have to restore the speed. We have to restore the speed by changing the load with the help of this particular valve position. Manually you change the position of the valve, so the water flow rate will be changed, and thus the load will also be changed till the speed is maintained constant. And whatever is the load that will be displayed on the dial, take the reading of the load by maintaining the speed constant once again. Now since the cylinder number 3 is cut out, the brake power which we estimate will be B1 to 4. So again we restore cylinder number 3, we cut out cylinder number 4, and we estimate the brake power B123 in the same way. In the same way. Okay. So this was the experimental procedure of the Morse test to find the frictional power and mechanical efficiency of four-cylinder IC engine. This is the apparatus we have seen. The procedure, we have seen the procedure also in detail, right? So first of all, we have to measure the force W by keeping all the cylinders in working condition, right? So these are the four cylinders, four levers are shown, and say suppose this is the cutout device, right? These are the four levers, and first of all the engine is running, and at a particular speed we find out the load W when all the four cylinders are working. Then we cut out the cylinder number one, or we cut out the various cylinders one by one, and just we estimate the brake power. We find the load W, we measure the load W, and we estimate the brake powers. So first of all, cylinder number one is cut out. Then we find out B234, or we estimate B234 by measuring the load W. Then this cylinder number one is restored, and the engine runs for some time. When with all the four cylinders working, then cylinder number two is cut out, and then we measure the load W. We estimate B134. Then cylinder number two is restored. The engine is run for some time with all the four cylinders working, and cylinder number three is now cut out, so that we get B124. And again, cylinder number three is restored, and the engine is run for some time with all the four cylinders working, and finally, cylinder number four is cut out. And we can estimate B123. So that is the procedure.